And welcome to the cultural center in Akure, in the Sunshine State, venue of Ondo State Governorship, Deputy Governorship debates, organized by the Nigerian Elections Debates Group, NEDG. Now, NEDG is a coalition of the Nigerian media, professional associations, women, youths, and civil society organizations. The Ondo State Governorship Debates Program is endorsed by the Independent National Electoral Commission, that's INEC, the Broadcasting Organizations of Nigeria, BORN, and the National Orientation Agency, NOAA. Let us quickly acquaint you with the details and rules of this debate tonight. There are 13 political parties participating in the election debates. We have relied strictly on the approved list of candidates issued by INEC. Now, the debate series shall run for 5 days with 2 sessions for the deputy governorship candidates, which ran on the 25th and 26th September, respectively. There are 3 sessions for the governorship debates for the 27th and the 28th of September and the 11th of October 2012. Now, the rules are the same for each session. Each candidate is allowed 3 minutes for opening statements. Questions are limited to the broad areas already disclosed to the candidates. Each candidate has 3 minutes, 3 minutes to answer each question. And there shall be 2 minutes allowed for the other candidates for reactions. The moderator and the panelists are allowed follow-up questions strictly based on issues raised in the reactions or rebuttal. Profane language is strictly not allowed. Direct attacks on candidates' personality are prohibited. The highest sense of decency and decorum must be maintained in the course of these debates. Candidates are allowed 2 minutes each for their closing statements. The time period allowed for questions to be answered must be strictly adhered to. Now, for the timing, the green light will indicate start. The amber is a warning that only 30 seconds are left, while the red light indicates a stop. You can see a demonstration of that here. When the candidates arrive at the rostrum, they will have a handshake and embrace one another and will do the same at the end of the debate. Now, none of us here on the panel is aware of the questions set for these debates. The questions will only be known in the course of these debates. There is in the auditorium a cross-section of the public which forms our audience tonight. The audience is not allowed to interrupt. The audience is not allowed to applaud, to cheer, to yell, or say anything while the debate is on. I'd like to repeat that, please. The audience is not allowed to applaud, to interrupt, to cheer, to jeer, yell, or say anything while the debate is on. I'm Lara Weyawise, AIT. I'm the moderator tonight, and with me are panelists. To my left, to my right is
Bayo Aborishade.
And to my left is
Dokunladele.
And our timekeeper tonight is Cyril Aidebama. Now, I'd like to invite Benga Abimbola for a Yoruba translation of all I've said tonight.
Eka bosi eto iforowero lori eto idibo ti ati owo NEDG gbe kale fun awon oludije si ipo gomina ati igbakeji won ni ipile Ondo. Ilanu awon ofin fun eto yi ni won yi. Igbimo eleni meta ti nse atokun ati awon omo igbimo meji ni yo dare eto na. Awon ero ti o wa ni kale ni yo ma fi oju sunukun wo bi eto na ti nlo lai dasi rara. Awon ero ti o wa ni kale yi ni ko ni ni anfani lati dasi boriyin fun tabi tabuku awon oludije nigba ti won ba dahun ibere won. Awon oludije ni yo ma dahun ibere ni isise ntele gege bi letter ti o bere oruko egbe oselu won. Oludije kan kan ni aye iseju meta lati soro apile sore. Oludije kan kan ni anfani iseju meta bakan na lati dahun ibere ti won ba bi. Se ifesi ni dahun. Nigbati oludije ba ti dahun ibere re ti akegbe re kankan ba ni oro lati so si ti o ba kan o ni aye iseju meji lati se eleyi. Awon ibere da lori awon oro gbogbo opo lori idagbasoke ipile Ondo. Atokun ati awon omo igbimo ti o ndari eto yi na ni anfani lati bere bere lowo awon oludije lori oro ton ba so nigba ton ba dahun bere ni isaju aro awon oludije lati yago patapata fun oro kubu oro agalamasa tabi oro ibani loruko je si akebe won lasiko itakuroso laarin won nitori na awon oludije gbudo soro towo towo tiyi tiyi ati teye teye gege bi eni ti o ndije fun ipo ti o ni olajulo ni ipinle yi oludije kankan ni iseju meji lati soro ikeyin tabi kasi oro e nile nigba ti idije ba fe pari awon oludije gbudo tele asiko ti a fun won lati dahun ibere fini fini lai koja asiko na nitori na ina monomono meta ni yo ma dari bi won se ma lo asiko won ina ikini ina alawo ewe green oni yo so fun won pe e bere si ni soro ina alawo funfun tabi yellow ni yo so fun won pe ogbon aya iseju lo ku fun yin nitori na e ma mura ati kasi oro nigba ti ina pupa yo so pe danu duro lakotan lati fi emi ife han awon oludije gbudo koko ki ara won ki won si di mora won ni kete ti won ba ti de gbagede yi lati ma dahun ibere ati nigba ti won ba ti pari eto na tan e se pupo e ku ikale.
Thank you very much indeed, Benga Abimbola. May I humbly request that we all switch off our phones or put them on curtsy mode. We all switch off our phones at this time or put them on curtsy mode. May I invite the chairman of the Nigerian Election Debates Group, Aremo Taiwo Alimi, for his opening remarks.
Good afternoon. From the Cultural Center Akure, Ondo State, I welcome you to the continuation of the 2012 governorship and deputy governorship debates in Ondo State, organized by the Nigerian Elections Debates Group, NEDG. My name is Taiwo Alimi. The NEDG election debates will today and tomorrow feature the governorship candidates unfolding their plans for Ondo State and the strategies of implementation before a radio and television live audience in Nigeria and abroad. In the past 2 days, we hosted the deputy governorship debates. The debates were well attended by the good people of Ondo State, who are widely acknowledged as enlightened and disciplined citizens of this nation. We thank our audience of the past 2 days, and we thank all of you here today most sincerely for your support and your presence. The NEDG is the largest, most credible, and most experienced debate group in Nigeria and Africa, and our activities have attracted the attention of the global community. The NEDG is non-partisan, non-political, and independent, established to ensure that election debates become a permanent component of Nigeria's democracy and culture. The responses NEDG has been receiving from Nigerians at home and abroad have been overwhelming and inspiring. The debates are designed to present to Ondo State and Nigerian electorate an opportunity to have first-hand information on the plans of governorship candidates. Governorship candidates will speak on a number of identified areas germane to state development and the sustenance of democracy in Ondo State. The governorship debate series will run for 5 days in Akure, 25th and 26th, we've done that, 27th and 28th September, and 11th October 2012. The debates are issue-based and issue-driven, not on persons, not religion, not ethnicity, and the debates are designed at setting public agenda by the candidates, which may form the basis of policy formulation and direction of government. Finally, the governorship debates program by NEDG is aimed at educating the electorate on issues in the October 28, 2012 elections in Ondo State. And through the election debates, NEDG is promoting political tolerance, constructive dialogue, and politics without bitterness. Once again, I welcome you to the 2012 NEDG governorship debates in Ondo State. I now proceed to hand over the envelopes containing the questions to the moderator and the panelists, which they will be seeing for the first time. Thank you most sincerely.
Thank you, Aremotayo Alimi. Let me verify again that we are seeing the questions for the very first time. We are seeing the questions for the very first time. Let me quickly introduce the political parties taking part in tonight's debate. They are the Allied Congress Party, the ACP, the All Nigeria People's Party, the ANPP, the African Political System, the APS, Better Nigeria Progressive Party, the BNPP, Change Advocacy Party, the CAP, the Congress for Progressive Change, CPC, and the National Conscience Party, the NCP. I'd like to invite the candidates to the rostrum at this time, but please remember that as you come up, you are to give one another a warm handshake, and you do the same at the end of the debate. May I invite the candidate of the Allied Congress Party, the ACP, Mr. Adeuti Taye, to the rostrum, please. You're most welcome. The candidate of the All Nigeria People's Party, the ANPP, Mr. Adeyemi Bolariwa, to please come to the podium as well. Mr. Adeyemi Bolariwa. Let me invite the candidate of the Africa Political System, the APS, to come to the rostrum, Comrade Adegoroye Tokunbo. Comrade Adegoroye Tokunbo makes his way here. Then the Better Nigeria Progressive Party, the BNPP, Olasegeri Gbenga Festus. Then the candidate of the Change Advocacy Party, the CAP, Mr. Omoyele Olorunwa. Mr. Omoyele Olorunwa. May I also invite the candidate for the Congress for Progressive Change, the CPC, Mr. Olusoji Ehinlanwo. Mr. Olusoji Ehinlanwo. And the candidate for the National Conscience Party, the NCP, Mr. Oladipo Lawrence. Mr. Oladipo Lawrence, the candidate for the National Conscience Party. I'd like to invite the chairman of the NEDG at this moment for some remarks. Aremo Taiwo Alimi, before we proceed.
Thank you very much. We have just received a message from the governorship candidate of the Change Advocacy Party, CAP, who is unavoidably absent because just about 1 hour ago, the sister-in-law died. Just about 1 hour ago, and he tendered his apology that he won't be able to be here. Thank you.
May I at this time invite the ushers to please declare this stand vacant for the candidates that are not here tonight, the CAP and the ANPP. All right, let's set the ball rolling. We have arranged you in an alphabetical order, so we'll take the questions that way, and then each one of you has to take a reaction based on what the other person has said. So I'll start with the Allied Congress Party of Nigeria, the ACPN. Being the governorship candidate of your party for the 20th of October 2012 election in Ondo State, this is a political landmark, I'm sure you agree with me. Will you share with us and with the Ondo State people your background and capacity that can lead to trust should you be elected governor of the state?
Thank you.
You have 3 minutes. Your time starts now.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Taye Adeuti. I'm from Idore, in Ondo State here. I went to primary school at Alade Idore. Went to Aquinas College, Akure, one of the best secondary schools here. Went to the Polytechnic, but where I read marketing, came out with a grade of distinction. Went to the University of Ibadan, the first and the best. I had my master's degree in business administration. I'm a private businessman after retiring from Nigerian Breweries. Thank you.
Why are you in this race? Why should?
Yes, I have come here to tell the redemption story. This is my state, and I want to contribute my quota to the growth and development of this state, so that when history of this state will be written, I will be counted among the people who have assisted our state and our people to join the Committee of Nations in accordance with the growth and development as emancipated in my manifesto. Thank you.
The APS, what new thing are you bringing to the table? That's after telling us who you are, what new thing are you bringing to the table?
Comrade Adegroye, by name. From Igbaroke. And as a prince, I think my identity is not hidden in Ondo State. And if I'm given opportunity to serve the good people of Ondo State, I think I'm going to perform to the best of my ability. And it has been the long-term yearning of my aspiration to serve the good people of Ondo State. Thank you.
The Better Nigeria Progressive Party.
Thank you. I'm Festus Solashigiri Olubenga. I'm a indigenous of Ipe Akoko, Akoko Southeast of Ondo State. I'm here tonight to tell the whole Ondo State that I want to serve them because I'm a youth. And I know the condition that face the youth of Ondo State right now. And the president that laid down already by the present day's administration, I believe maybe we can build upon it. And I'm going to develop our economies that already died. I'm going to develop it, and I'm going to do something that make people laugh in this state. Thank you.
All right, the CPC.
My name is Oluso Jenyilangwo. I come from Ilaje. I had my primary education at Ladilac Primary School in Lagos, secondary education at Lagos State Government College, Ojo, and proceeded to university at Ondo State University, now known as Ekiti State University, where I had a BA honors in English. And then I had an MBA from the University of East London, East London Business School. I've got a background of, I've worked in global organizations, private sector and public sector, very deep public sector change experience. Worked in organizations such as Capgemini, Atos Origin, and in recent times, an European Commission. So I've got, I've also, worked in ensuring transformational change in at the Inland Revenue in the UK. So very deep public sector change experience, which I hope to deploy for the benefit of Ondo State. I've worked in Nigeria at very top levels. So I've come with a big mix of background exposure to very international environments and a deep insight of Nigerian problems, Ondo State problems in particular. Those are the things I bring on board. So those things I hope to deploy for the benefit of our state, to take our state to very great heights. And, I'm very passionate about change. I haven't been a change consultant for several years. And I think that with me at the helm of affairs in Ondo State will rise higher.
The National Conscience Party, please.
Thank you very much. Oladipo Bolade Lawrence is my name. I'm from Ikari Akoko, Ondo State. My secondary school, Virgil College. I later attended Ondo State College of Art and Science. I proceeded to University of Ilorin, where I read geology. I can say it categorically that since after my service year in 1987, I've been on my own. I know what it takes. I'm an employer of labor. I've traveled all over the world. I am a freight forwarder presently, and I belong to Council for the Regulation of Freight Forwarding in Nigeria. I am of Port Consultative Council. I am a member, and I belong to a lot of social class. And my intention of coming to Ondo State is actually to come and contribute my own quota to the economic, social, and political development of the state. Also, because of my experience in life, and because I've risen from the grass to the grace, I want to share that opportunity with the whole people of Ondo State, if given that opportunity. Thank you very much.
All right, I'll call on my panelists to throw the next question.
Well, my question goes thus. We don't all look hungry, but a lot of people in Ondo State are hungry. how can you, how would you like to guarantee food security for the people of Ondo State? What are your plans and how do you intend to carry this through?
And that question goes to you, the APS, and it goes round after his answer. We all go round, take two minutes for a rebuttal, and then we come to you for the next question.
Thank you very much, the moderators. Personally, I will not agree that the people of Ondo State are hungry, because in all ramifications, we are farmers. We may not have money to procure the natural identities that we open our minds to the third world generations. Now, we are not hungry. Since we are farmers, I don't think we can be hungry. I may like you possibly to put it the question in another way. But if you say the people are living below average level, I may agree with you because of some things or the other, which we come on board to actualize. That is why I am vying for the position of governorship in Ondo State. Thank you.
You said people are living below poverty level.
Yeah.
You're vying for the position of governor of Ondo State.
Yeah.
How do you plan to bring them above poverty level?
Now, thank you for that question. I'm waiting for that question. The poverty level of our people can be raised. Now, if you want to raise the poverty level of our people, we need to put in some things. There are some things that has been degenerated in this state. We are talking of this state in particular, but in general, in Nigeria, the situation is not peculiar to Ondo State alone. We are addressing the problem of Nigeria as a whole. Now, if you want to address the poverty in Ondo State in particular, there are some strategies that we put in place, that these strategies we address directly these issues. So the strategies is, one, industrialization. We industrialize our society. If you want to industrialize our society, then we need to do certain things also. Now, we encourage the urban-rural migration. We don't encourage rural-urban migration. There are a lot of urban-rural migration, but we need to encourage the rural-urban migration. That is the situation. Then, further, we'll be going on with it. Thank you.
The BNPP.
So I agree with what the APS have just said. Because if you want to eradicate poverty, you said Ondo State people are hungry. Yeah, is it hungry or whatever you said? I just want to tell you in this way. If you look at the survey showing that 75% of people in Ondo State, they are peasant farmer living in the rural area. How do you tell us that we are hungry? We are not hungry in Ondo State. We are not hungry. If you say that we are hungry, well, I will disagree or not, I will agree. But to me, personally, why I'm like to come on board to say, okay, people, please vote for me and I want to become a governor of Ondo State. I know that we have about 18 local governments in Ondo State. By the version of this, I believe that I can establish agricultural settlements. At least if I do it, I will have each local government will have their own. At least I believe that about 1,000 workers will be there working, producing food for the people of Ondo State. It's not only crop rotation alone. We are going to produce a piggery, a fishery, which was already on grant cattle, which already the present government is already done. But notwithstanding, I'm going to build upon it more than what it did. That is my own. Thank you.
The CPC, please.
I think to a large extent, I agree with you. I've traversed the length and breadth of this state, and I see to a very large degree hunger on the faces of people. I see squalor and poverty, and certainly for me, I'm not impressed. I think that we need to, for us to be able to tackle this problem, we need to focus on agriculture, ensuring, largely food sufficiency. And one of the ways to do that is to take our agriculture from the subsistence level to a commercial level, large-scale agricultural production, if you like. I think that, we need to, my government, if the people of Ondo State elect, bring it into power, will promote the creation of, will encourage the creation of cooperatives across the state. We'll support cooperatives, which will be an important engine for increasing food production. We also ensure that private sector investors to come into Ondo State, to tap from the vast agricultural potentials of Ondo State, so that we can ensure that nobody in this state goes to bed hungry. We will do our very best in that regard. Government will also set up, farm settlements to be able to ensure that our people are largely well fed. And apart from agriculture, we will also ensure we'll try to stimulate investment, encourage the creation of medium-scale and small-scale enterprises that will provide jobs for our people, so that we increase the number of people who we decrease the number of people who are unemployed. Because it's when people are unemployed, they have nothing to do. That's when they can get hungry.
I'm afraid your time is up. The National Conscience Party.
As a party for the grassroots, I agree with you totally, because a farmer in the village, if not given adequate incentive, might produce to feed himself and his immediate family alone. Having said that, if I'm voted into power, I'll first of all establish what we call farm settlement. The farm settlement, I'll make sure that there are modern facilities, like even the telephone, even television, just to discourage the farmer from moving from their farm to the urban center. Again, I will make sure that I provide a soft loan for the farmer in form of cooperative, because if they are encouraged by giving them loan, definitely they will perform better. Then I will try to do some incentive to the farmers, because if you give some incentive to people, they will strive to do more. I also arrange, because there are some areas where we have crops only one section of the year. In order to have crops throughout the year, I will make sure I encourage the farmer by providing irrigation system, so that at the end of the day, they can do their farming throughout the year. Also, I will make sure that I provide what we call enlightenment campaign to the farmers, so that they can be, susceptible to the new way of farming. I will also do what we call encouragement by providing soft loan, as I said, and also make sure that whatever they want, they are given at a particular time. Thank you very much.
I just need to get you very well, the NCP. Did you say you provide TVs and phones for the farmers?
That is what I mean. I said in their farm settlements.
Okay.
In order to make them very comfortable.
Okay.
So that they will serve as if they are not lacking anything that is being enjoyed in the urban center.
I just needed to get that.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. The ACPN.
Yes, thank you very much. First of all, to ensure that we eat, we have enough food, we have to change our orientation to agriculture. Everybody must farm. Now, at my age, I have inherited the farm led by my father and my grandfather, and I have. A few months ago, some people in Ibadan, the Hausas bringing tomatoes and other things, they went on strike. Suddenly, those of us in the West were shivering because we could not do what our parents would do. What does it cost people? First of all, I would like Environmental Day, I will declare Agri Day, everybody to the farm, including the governor. Plant something, even if it is something that you will use to feed your family, plant something. Now, as a government, I will encourage the farmers, and the surplus will be bought by the government. We will build silos so that and liaise with agencies that will make sure that the silos work. So when, because what discourages, if you go out now, you will see tomato and yams, they are wasting. about 10 tubers of yam, maybe just 500 naira. And others will be wasted. When I get to the government, I will make sure that the excess will be bought from the farmers and kept. We'll convert them to yam powder. Look at tomato, then rice. Rice is not our food. When we were young, we took rice just Easter and rice is not our food. So why are we running after rice? And I know that there are some of our people, if you really like, that could plant rice. In our town there, when we were young, as early as about 1950, let's say, we had a rice mill, and about four or five farmers in the locality, we plant rice that we feed the whole population. So rice, why should we have to be running after rice? As if, thank you.
All right, my panelists, another question for you, and you will start the answer.
Building a private sector-driven economy for Ondo State should top the priority of any serious state government, any serious administration. And you can achieve this through industrialization. I want to know the strategies you want to put in place to attract investors to Ondo State.
Well, the panelist, is very simple. And I want to assure you that all the moribund industry that have already died, I will believe that I'm going to build them, I'm going to revive them first before I establish any other industry. By the version of this, you know, like Uluwa glasses at Ibokoda, ceramic industry at Ifon, and other industry we have in Ondo State. I believe that by the time we equip them first, so our government will establish another new one. We now move out to go and look how the other people are doing in outside. Maybe we travel travel to abroad to see what is going on there, or maybe we invite investors to come and assist us in Ondo State. By the version of this, I believe that if this all this method is implemented by our party, I believe things will be okay. And as well, you know, I don't want to talk about employment again for now, because you didn't ask me a issue of employment. But this thing, by doing all this, you know, the employment we start from that place. We employ people there. At least the people of Ondo State, the youth who are not having a job, they will get jobs through the industrialization, and the economies of this state will be boosting. At least when people are working, at least like a ceramic industry, maybe it's working, and the Uluwa glasses is working. You know, people will be going there, are buying things, the producer, at least our people in Ondo State, we are not going to be lack anymore. So that is all I believe about our economy. And those things, the issue of infrastructure and other places, all.
I'm afraid your time is up. I still want to take you up a bit, if I may. You have not told us the strategy and how you plan to get the support of development partners. That's the question. Your strategy and how you will get the support of development partners to come to Ondo State.
Okay, thank you. You know, the issue of strategies is very simple, because to me, I believe the current government presently now, they are doing something. They are inviting investors to Ondo State. They are doing something about the industries that to improve and develop the industry of the Ondo State. I just believe that if the good people of Ondo State will be voted us on 28th of Ondo State, October, I believe that we are going to do something better, and we are going to make them laugh, and the region of industry, we are going to do something, we are going to develop it. Thank you.
All right, the CPC, please.
I think that drawing investors, development partners into Ondo State, private investors, would require creating the necessary environment, to encourage these investors to come and put their money in Ondo State. I think putting in the right infrastructure, that will bring them in is very, very important. I think that ensuring that you have a rapid development of infrastructures from road, light, water. This sort of things will encourage investors to come into the country, into the state. You also have to give them a feeling that you have a state that is peaceful, that where you have harmonious relationship. No investor wants to put his money where there's instability, even political instability. So, in a nutshell, putting the right infrastructure, electricity, having an industrial centers or villages and all of that, where you have all the facilities that people would normally want to see when they invest, that can encourage them. Even tax breaks for investors, I'll probably put in place if my government is elected, if we're elected into government, I'll put in place tax breaks for potential investors. These sort of things will engender a serious consideration of the state for investment.
All right, the National Conscience Party.
I think the issue of industrialization in Ondo State is basically centered around power. Even if you want to talk of the maribond industry, if you want to revive the industry without power, adequate power supply, one is just merry-go-rounding what is not even available. I will first of all tackle the issue of power, so that at the end of the day, because even if you resuscitate the ceramic industry today, and you have to power the ceramic industry with either thermal or any form of electricity generator, you would discover that you are producing at loss. Then secondly, I'll make sure that there is enabling environment, very favorable enabling environment. In terms of security, I'll make sure that the security of the state is very, very, is taken good care of, so that the investor will know that bringing their money to partner with us will be very safe. Then coupled with the fact that most of the roads, we'll make sure that the roads are very okay. Then secondly, because of the movement of the goods, both the raw material and the finished goods, align with the appropriate government organ to develop the coastal area of Ondo State. That area, we have the longest coastal area, which favor deep sea port. I will align with the appropriate authority to make sure that the port is finished or is constructed at appropriate time. And also, I will make sure that the social amenities that favored the people who have to establish the industry with us are all available. Thank you very much.
You mentioned something about power.
Yeah.
And I think that is vital.
Very vital.
I agree with you 100%.
Thank you.
But how are you going to cross the hurdle of the legal hurdle between states and FIDRA in relation to power generation and distribution?
Thank you very much. We are not just coming to Ondo State to say this is what we want to do. We have what we call research and development center within the party. All this we've taken into consideration. What we do is this: we align with private participation in generating this power supply. This we can do, and as well, when we now generate the power, because the major problem between the federal and the state is in area of distribution. What we do is that after generating our own power, we now sell to the federal government or for additional into national grid. That's what we're going to do.
All right. CPN.
Industrialization of Ondo State is could be viewed as a big problem, and it's not a problem. The first question is that why are other states industrialized? Most of the resources of these states are being used to develop Ikeja and look at Cocoa House. We call it Cocoa House. There is no cocoa in Ibadan. There is no cocoa in Ikeja. So if you want to industrialize, we'll make sure that, first of all, the environment is conducive. Secondly, we have, in this part of the, among the Odua, we have Odua conglomerate. It's an investment conglomerate owned by Ondo State and other states. We are not benefiting from it. They are risk avatars. They don't take risk. They just go around, collect rent from a Western house and share it. When I become the governor, it's not going to be so. We are going to give them assignment. Every state must be industrialized. How are other states industrialized? No, those states it's not. The power problem will be solved. We have representatives in the parliament. They will be asked to liaise with the federal government and make sure that there is power. Not that, and we will share it according to some agreed ratio. Then we will have technical partners. For example, look at Nigerian Breweries, where I served throughout my working career. I've never worked in this service. They are producing. And people are drinking it. We have had research and development people there, our friends, whom we have been moving with for the past 23 years. They'll be asked to come to our state. And we know, we are aware of how they are being done. So we invite them. The trick they used in putting those batteries in other places, let them come and do it in our state. Everybody must work, and we must be industrialized. Thank you.
The APS.
Much. When we are talking of industrialization, all the previous administrations, they had it in mind. But we politicians, we can talk on policies, but the policies are easier said than done. The industrialization in Ondo State, every administration has been trying to do it, but we just say it and we forget about it. The problem is that the industries that has been in Ondo State, what killed it? That is the question. We must inquire into that question. What killed those industries, Ifon Ceramic, what killed it? What killed Oluwa Glass? What killed Okitupa Oil Palm? What killed all those industries? We must inquire into that. It is not that we just come here and say, we want to do this, we want to do that. We can say it, but how are we going to establish this? Now, first, the corruption killed it. We killed it. It's corruption. Power, we have power problem. The past administration, they just put some people there. Instead of producing oil at Okitupa, the managers and some other people, they'll be packing it to their houses, or they'll be selling it at a cheaper rate to their cronies. So the corruption killed all these industries. Do you think that if I am given an opportunity to be the director, to be a sole owner of Ifon Ceramic, it will die like that? No, there are a lot of industries that are in Ondo State that are thriving on entrepreneurial ground. So these things, we must address corruption even before we address power. That is the situation of things. If we are going to industrialize Ondo State, we must address corruption. Corruption killed our industries and subsequently the light, the power. So IPP.
I'm afraid your time is up.
Thank you,
sir. I'd like to throw the next question to the CPC, and that has to do with education. Free education rather than quality education has always been canvassed as one of the core manifestos of many politicians in Nigeria. I'm sure you agree with that. What are your concrete plans to align free and quality education in Ondo State if elected governor?
Well, I think first and foremost, I believe that free and qualitative education, up to free functional qualitative education up to secondary school level is possible. And so I think that cutting waste, ensuring that government resources are deployed rightly, can make will make free education possible in Ondo State. We are a rich state, and I believe that we can do it. And the way to do it is to, you know, like I said, cut waste in different areas of governance, ensure that you build schools which across the state. On the CPC level, we want to be able to build schools across the nooks and crannies of Ondo State. Not we don't believe in mega schools or whatever. We believe in schools that are accessible to the people in the nooks and crannies of the state. And all of these schools will have be able to provide qualitative education because we will ensure that they are equipped with the necessary equipment, particularly ICT, laboratories and all of that, science laboratories. So we can do it with the political will and ensuring that government places emphasis on the priorities, education for a CPC government, if elected, it's a top priority, and for us is education, because that's the bedrock of a society that will go places. So cutting Western government and placing premium on the priorities is the strategy.
Education.
Yeah.
Education is free education. You said it's possible from primary up to secondary level.
Yes.
Are you not worried about sustainability? You bring computers, you bring teachers and all of that, and then you can't pay them afterwards. Are you not worried about that? How do you plan to sustain what you want to give the people of Ondo State, what you call free? It has to be continuous, don't you think so?
Well, if I understand you very well, you're talking about the funding for this. Let me say, part of the problem that we have not just in this state and in the country, is government not understanding or appreciating the priorities that it should place on things. If we have enough resources, we have the money from the Federation account, we are going to try to boost internally generated revenues of the state, and we're going to also find several other sources of income. So, like I said, cutting waste is integral. If we put our priorities right, we can fund education free and provide qualitative education. And in addition, we can provide a first-class university that supports research and all of that.
The National Conscience Party.
We support, or we can provide free and qualitative education to secondary level. I can say categorically that the mega school concept is not a bad idea. Because nowadays you will see that the mega school concept has actually bridged the difference between the wealthy people and the people from the poor background. Having said that, you will discover that even at tender age now, you will discover that using that mega school concept, you will discover that children see or have computer to themselves. Apart from that, because of the education is basically based on teachers, we are going to give incentive to the teachers. We make teachers comfortable and give them their promotion as that went due, because it is when somebody is happy that you get best out of that person. We make sure the teachers are well remunerated. We make sure that all the dilapidated school in the state is well refurbished and put to test, because there is no gain saying that there is nothing good in mega school. I'm of opinion that because governance should be a continuous exercise. If there is continuity, you will see within a period of time, all these dilapidated schools will be faded away, and you will see that the mega school will have its way. Thank you very much.
No. All right, the ACPN. But before you answer, please, I'd like to announce that you have bottles of water there. If you get thirsty, you just want to sip as we proceed. Thank you.
Thank you.
I quite support the fact that free and qualitative education is possible, but with some modification. For example, now, when we were in school here, at Aquinas, the earliest time, by 2 o'clock, we are already on siesta, and we're doing very well. But if we go out now, thanks for the governor who has just introduced buses, seeing children loitering 4 or 5 o'clock, what are they looking for? No. So free education is possible, but with some modification. One, there must be heavy competition. If I come there, the government will return the mission school to the owners. The government will build their school. The private people will build their schools. There will be competition. When we were here, Aquinas was here, Fiwashaye was here, St. Louis was here, and others, they were doing very well. Then secondly, if it's a boys' school, let the men be there. If you go to our school now, you will see that 80% of the teachers are female in a completely boys' school. How can there's no discipline? So free education will go with discipline. The resources are available in the state. Those who can, if at the tertiary level, we'll give them bursaries and scholarship for the bright ones. So pre-education is possible, but all we have to do is with some modifications and let there be heavy competition. Let there be private schools, let there be government schools, let there be missionary schools, then there will be competition. Thank you.
You let there be private schools, let there be government schools, yes. Let there be missionary schools,
yes.
And all these will be free?
Well, especially the teachers. The teachers in all those schools will be handled by the government. I understand. It could even be free, it doesn't matter. Because all the people going to those schools are indigenous of Ondo State. And even those not in Ondo, we know the resources of Ondo State. And they can fund it, because they are all people. But what you want is that you can't know more than your teachers. If the schools compete heavily among themselves, there will be a lot of improvement. And it will either, I have never worked there.
The APS.
Thank you very much. Free education. When we talked about free education in the olden days, in the Southwest that Awolowo operated free education, we have less than 2,000 students across the board, both from primary schools to university. There are far less than 2,000 students and pupils. Now we are talking of millions. So, as I would say, if you think education is expensive, why can't you buy ignorance? If we are saying free, to what level is it going to be free? Do we appreciate free things? Do you put your children to free schools? Don't you know how much you pay on your children, both nationally and internationally? I will not subscribe to full free education. I will subscribe to motivation. How do we motivate the students and the parents and the teachers? What are we doing to motivate them? This will immensely promote education in our sectors. And we should forget about saying free or no free. That is not the question. How can we improve education in our state? Improvement that we put in incentives to the students. You will see a graduate that graduated with first class moving with leg across the state, and you see somebody that has not gone to school at all moving with gym. Why don't we encourage these people and motivate them? Put the good people, the good students at the helms of affairs in education. This will promote education. And the teachers, pay them all allowances, pay them all their dues. This education will improve. After you, the teachers take home cannot take them home. And I cannot be a teacher because of that synonymous situation. That is the fact. Thank you very much.
Yes, I just want to, there are many distractions.
Okay.
And when we are talking about education, apart from free education that you have been talking about, we have distractions such as cultism, industrial actions, and other vices in various institutions in all over the country.
Yeah.
How do you intend to address this problem?
Thank you very much.
If elected.
Thank you very much. The situation I've just mentioned, cultism is possible. How do we pay for the students that merit excellence? Do we pay for them? That is exactly what I've just said. Provide jobs. Recruit all these brains that graduated from university or in our higher institution. While the president was given some people incentives when they came from World Cup, the Flying Eagle or whatsoever, they gave them money. These are motivative gestures. So why can't we give it to education sector? First class, give them incentives. Come and put them to Ministry of Education. Let them use their brain, the Ministry of Education, instead of paying them 20,000 and they'll be shouting on minimum wage, 20,000 minimum wage, when some of us are paying millions of naira. Why can't you join courts? When you know that cultism, when you are into it, you will have a friend that will even take you to overseas. While you make first class, you'll be roaming about the street, doing nothing. So the society has encouraged all these societal crimes.
There are all these societal vices. Our society, they have encouraged this. Even you have not talked of this from Yahoo boys. These Yahoo, they just graduated to Yahoo. Because when you see a lecturer moving with Okada, and a Yahoo boy will be moving with Jeep on campus. So that is the reality. Education is no more, there's no more incentives in education. Don't let us deceive ourselves. Now, if I am voted in as the governor of Ondo State, the first thing I will do in education is to motivate our students, the teachers, and the parents. We will motivate the students, all the sectors, we will motivate them. Then you see that there will be a tremendous improvement in all these activities. Thank you.
The BNPP, we're still talking about how you plan to, your concrete plans to align free and quality education in Ondo State if elected governor.
Thank you. To me and my party, we believe one thing. Before, when talking about education, education before you gain education, education is a power. And, you know, we need to put some things in place, like retraining and retraining teachers to meet the standards, standard and international level. One, before you can't just be saying that we declare free education in Ondo State. It's not, at least to me, I didn't buy the idea. The reason is that if you equip the teachers, the buildings is okay. All the infrastructures already put in place. At least, if we have a conducive environment, I mean, our students are living, I mean, are studying in a conducive environment, I believe that nobody will be talking of going to private school, going to this and this, because by putting your children into private school these days, you know, you will be paying a good amount of money. But in a situation where you equip the primary schools, secondary school, you build schools for them, maybe in the rural area, you go to them, you go to that aspect of that area, I mean, to that area, you build, and the school built, and the solid infrastructure being put in place, there's nobody will be talking of free education. Free education in only this, as the APS say, because the population of the students are not many then. But nowadays, it's not easy. Like Okorocha that's operating free education in Imo. You know, Okorocha himself is a multi-millionaire before he gets to that office. So we can't, to me, I can't compare myself with Okorocha. And even federal government, they can't compare themselves with Okorocha. I must tell you the truth. Thank you.
Okay, the next question.
Yeah. CPC, if your ticket is elected, what would be your health policy direction that your administration will pursue? I think.
You started the last question, the last round.
Did you?
Yeah, I
you started with education.
I did the last question on education, yeah.
Okay. Yeah, so then you start the NCP.
NCP.
Can I?
Yeah. If your ticket is elected, what would be your health policy direction?
Thank you very much. As the going says, health is wealth. What I will first of all look at is what are the things that brings about sickness. I will first of all look at those things holistically. Make sure that I put in place some measure to actually doubt what can bring about sickness. For instance, eradication of mosquito, making sure that there is pipe-borne water everywhere, and all that. Apart from that, again, I will make sure that there are health facilities in every nook and cranny of the state. I'll make sure that there are health center in the villages. I'll make sure that there, because as we are talking now, it is obvious that we have general hospital nearly in all the local government headquarters. And what I will only do is to do some build up in what is already on the ground, making sure that what any facility, because as I said earlier, my research and development center will look at all these parameters and make adequate information available to me. Because in my party, we have this way of going
to issues. We don't just look at the issue peripherally. We make sure that we look at the cost and we nip something at the point of need. What we'll do again is to make sure we'll make sure that every hospitals and health facilities in the state are of standard. We make sure that drugs are available. We make sure that every doctors are well remunerated. We make sure that all the workers also are well remunerated. Apart from that, I will go ahead and create this sanitary inspector because there is need for it nowadays. If in the days of sanitary inspector, we discover that most of these diseases that are thriving now are no more. But because of the fact that we are no more going to that, that is why we can see that nowadays you will see your gutters everywhere so dirty, your environment so dirty, without anybody challenging you. I'll make sure I create this sanitary inspector and make sure that they are well equipped, and to the best of my knowledge, they'll be doing their job accordingly. Thank you very much.
May I just take you up a bit, if I may? Can you name maybe three modern medical equipment that you will bring, especially to the rural areas where they don't have access, you know, to the general hospitals and the cities and all that? Just three modern medical equipment,
yes,
to empower primary health care at the grassroots. Just, yes, three. One.
I think one is I will make sure that there is incubator in hospitals in villages.
Two.
Because, okay, I'll make sure that I will import diagnostic, very sophisticated diagnostic equipment into the health center. What I mean by diagnostic, you know, there.
The question goes to you, the ACPN.
Okay, medical equipment.
No.
Okay, health, Abi.
Yes.
Okay, about health. If you study the human body, God has built the human body in such a way that you are expected to be healthy, provided you take good food. That is the first solution. Because there's a Yoruba adage that says good food is the antidote to good health. If you eat very well, but if you are poor, you are likely to be sick. And if you are sick, you are not likely to be well utilized. So the first thing is that the environment must be good enough for you to eat good food. For example, I've not been to the hospital for the past 6 years. I don't. I'm not saying everybody will be like me, but most of the people will be like that because you eat very well. Balanced diet. If you do that, the antibodies in the body, you are aiding them. So they will be ready to fight any diseases. But should there be any cause for you to go to the hospital, we'll make sure that all the hospitals are well equipped. For example, when we were young, the Akure Hospital was the only general hospital here. But we knew that Chief Awolowo, almost every month, we will have some vehicles loaded with doctors and nurses. They'll be going to villages, treating people. My father used to be an interpreter in that time. I would say, go and bring Taye. He'll say, what's wrong with you? And whoever cannot be treated that will be referred to Dr. Akechete in the hospital here. So those things will be encouraged. But besides that, it is good food, healthy living, because if you ask the doctor will say, go and take care of your personal hygiene. It is good food that take care of your health. Thank you.
So one of your policies for healthcare in Ondo State is for people to eat well.
Well, balanced right. Diet.
The APS.
The health sector, you will agree with me that the previous administrations in Ondo State, both previous and the present ones, they have been doing well concerning the health, nationally and internationally. So, health-wise, I can just come there as the governor of Ondo State. We improve on health policy that the previous administrations has embarked upon. That's all.
You want to improve on what the previous administration has embarked upon?
Yes, because they have done well.
What have they embarked upon that you want to improve on, if I may ask?
Okay, if I come to government again, like if you allow me to mention, The comprehensive health center is in all local governments of Ondo State. We have 18 of it like that, built by Dr. Olusegun Agagu. And the basic health center, the same way. Then coming to this present administration, the mother and child there is all high cynosure. What do we call it? Diagnostic center, Galifianimi Diagnostic Center at Ondo. These are all the internationally, they have recognized all these projects that I am talking about, not me. Now, if I come, I cannot do better than that, than to improve on it. That is the truth.
The BNPP.
Thank you. To me, with my party, we believe that we are going to improve on what the previous and past administration have done concerned about AIDS, because the most painful area is that. I would like to move to the rural area, because most of our rural area, they are lacking of a health. There is no health facility. There is nothing. So some of them will be trekking from one place to another before they could get to a place like, I mean, a place where there is health centers, general hospitals. They will board a vehicle. Some of them, they will travel from one place to another. But, you know, if you see, if we as a party, my party and I, we want to do something about health, we are going to start with to include the good facility, what they're supposed to be, at least the need, which if you get to, maybe you're a pregnant woman, if you get to hospital, wherever you will get you, you don't need to be carried, as you be saying, they will put you on ground before they start working with you. First thing, I need there is equipment. I believe that everything, the other things is very simple. Like I will provide water, electricity, standby generator, and the pregnant women will be paid. I will pay them, because you know it's not easy to carry a woman will be carried pregnant for about 9 months or 8 or 9 months. At least they will be paid. They need to be compensated. And as well, if you look at the present administration, he established a BA.
Sorry, did you say you provide water, electricity, and then generators?
Standby generator.
If you provide electricity, you provide standby generators.
There is no, you know, at times, if there is no electricity, standby generator will start working. So there is no kind of a problem in that at that particular place.
The CPC, please.
Well, let me just say straight away that my policy trust will be remarkably different from the present government, in the sense that, you know, I will not create hospitals or health centers that are far away from the people. You know, what I'm going to do is to put in place, first and foremost, hospitals that across the nooks and crannies of health centers across the nooks and crannies of this state, in a way that our people in the rural areas, in the remotest of areas, are able to have easy access to health facilities. I will ensure that the existing hospitals move from the many of them are in a decadent state. I will ensure that they are well equipped and made very modern, such that they can, you know, compete with any health center or hospital of their status. I think that it's important also to ensure, you know, apart from ensuring that, you know, people have access to health facilities across the state, they don't have to travel from, you know, I know that people in Nigeria, for example, or in some other parts of the state, some of them have to travel over several miles and kilometers to be able to get access to good, proper health facilities. You can imagine what will happen, while they are traveling, because these facilities are not accessible. So, that would be an important policy trust. In addition, I will also ensure that alternative healthcare, alternative medicine, medical practitioners are promoted. I have found out from experience that herbal medicine, non-octodox medicine, it's very, very important to well-being. I want to improve this. I want to support the creation of this kind of health centers, you know, and bring in people who are well-trained and qualified.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, thank you very much. Unemployment is a global problem, and Ondo State is having its share of the problem. I believe many youths from Ondo State are watching this program live. What plan do you have for unemployed youths in Ondo State?
That's the ACPN.
Okay. Unemployment is global, but it's not insurmountable. We have mentioned about agriculture. Our people are afraid of going to the farm because of cutting grass or cutting wood. No! There are so many things in agri that does not mean that you have to be in the farm. For example, you can go into poultry. You can go into piggery. You can go into goatry. All those are still part of agriculture. But because you have gone to the university, you have read chemistry, you have read physics, so you want to work in the secretariat. All of us cannot work in the secretariat. The solution to unemployment, one of it is agriculture. Be self-employed and face it. If I become the governor, I will encourage and I will lead leadership by example. I told you earlier that I will go to the farm. There will be Agri Day, like Environmental Day. These children will be encouraged to have their farms. They will have their farms. The government will encourage them. Then the surplus, whatever they make in them, will be bought by the government so that there will be no waste. Because if we have surplus, especially during a season, if there is surplus and nobody buys it from you, you'll be losing. But whatever the surplus will be bought. Secondly, there will be construction. All over the country, all over the state, there will be construction. Students will be encouraged to go there and join. Then technical school. That is where you have artisans. When you ask a graduate of civil engineering to go and do labourer job, he will say no. But if it's from a technical school, I think that one has to be phased up now. There will be technical schools. People will be driving tractors, people will be builders, people will be molders, people will be turners. You turn them out, you discover that there will be no situation whereby people will not be employed. So that is the solution. The only way to agree will solve 70% of our unemployment problem.
May I ask you if you know the number of graduates?
Yes.
In Ondo State?
Yes.
And if you know the percentage of the youth that are unemployed at the moment?
Well, I cannot say I know the number of graduates in Ondo State. But I know, even in my family, there are some people who are not employed. But I have reorientated them. They have not gone back to our father's farm. And now, occasionally, when I come home, they say, but this is some of the proceeds from our farm. They are happy. So if you can do that, encourage them. We cannot go to Alagbaka to work. Encourage them to go to the farm. Not only cutting and planting yam. You can be in poultry, fishing, fingerlings will be sold by the government to them at subsidized rate. When they do that for about 6 months, they will be happy. They could even be borrowing us money. There's nothing wrong in agri. It is their orientation. They have thought that once you are a graduate, you must have it. That time is gone. No more white-collar job. Everybody must work.
I actually asked for the percentage of graduates and unemployed youths. All right, the African Political System Party.
Yeah, thank you very much. I will say categorically that in Ondo State, about 50,000 students graduate every year in Ondo State. And these 50,000, they are thrown into an unemployment market. Now, how do we improve this? We can improve on this by encouraging entrepreneurial activities. How do we encourage entrepreneurial activities? Giving anyone that is interested. When we are saying we are doing empowerment, I don't count 50,000, 100,000 as empowerment. Like myself, I've never prayed to receive salary. I prayed to pay salary. Now, if you give people money, enough money, to trade or to do business, you encourage entrepreneurial activities. We can improve our unemployment rates. We can reduce it by giving incentives entrepreneurial. We can encourage entrepreneurial activities. Then the PPP, the private public-private partnership, we can encourage it. Bring people in to industrialize our rural areas. We need to develop rural areas. I lay emphasis. Please, we need to improve our rural areas. This will discourage the urban rural migration. We need to encourage the urban rural drift. We don't need to encourage rural urban drift, because the rural urban drift, they have jeopardized all the economic activities in the rural areas. Thank you.
Yeah, would you like to tell us, in terms of entrepreneurship, what skills and how much are you going to be devoting of your budget to empowering people, small scale, medium scale, large scale, so that they can employ how many from the 50,000 about that you mentioned?
Thank you very much. We have the existing entrepreneurial specialists in the state. We need to encourage them. Now, even the graduates, the assistants, they are not ready to learn any work because they are not motivated, they are not encouraged. So we need to give them little money, just little money. Little money can start business.
The BNPP. Remember at the beginning you told us that I am a youth. So for the youths watching from all over the world, let them hear from you the plans you have for them as October 20 draws near.
Thank you. I would like to, earlier I told you that I would like to start with agriculture, because I told you that we have about 18 local governments. When talking of employment, it's very easy with my party, we believe that agriculture will boost issue of employment in Ondo State. Because by the time we create farm settlements in all the local 18 local governments, by employing the youths that are ready to work to that agricultural settlement, I believe that 18,000 workers are already on ground. By that aspect, I will move to our parasitas. I believe for now there is not much employment in this state, but they are employed people. But notwithstanding, I want to tell you one thing. I will tell the PANSEC, the people in the ministry, that okay, what is vacancy is on ground for us. Please, I want to do employment, because I know that the problem of employment is the paramount issue in Ondo State. And meanwhile, this present government, they are employing youths, but it's not as much the people are expected. But notwithstanding, I believe that our party will try to create employment. And as well, we are going to recruit teachers to all the schools we made mention that we are going to establish to rural area. We are not going to put dogs, we are not going to put a cow, we are going to put human beings. So I believe, thank you.
Youth and farming. What is, I'm sure you agree with me that not many youths today would buy the idea that they want to go into farming.
Thank you.
How do you want to
let me tell you something. I would like to convince you.
Confuse me?
I would like to convince the people of Ondo State sense that what I mean is this. You know, the present administration, they are giving credible facilities, seedlings, they are to the others. We are not going to do that. We are going to establish visible mechanism agriculture.
by the way that every individual farming, maybe you call yourself as a youth, we'll be giving tractors, solid equipment that will be using you. You feel as if you are in office, working in office. You are not going to work with working with hardship. We are not going to employ people, say, okay, I want come and do this, come and do that for me. You are going to work and you leave the place. So the people that working, in the office, they will meet you. If by the time the two of you met, they will know that this guy, at least, where are you working? They will ask you, where are you working? Because they believe that you two are in office. So thank you.
Yeah. I wanted to ask, you brought up this idea of farm settlements in the 18 local governments.
Yes, sir.
What would be the focus of each if you consider the climatic belt of Ondo State?
Thank you. What
would be the focus of each of your farm settlements How are you going to establish them?
Thank you, sir. By established farm settlements in Ondo State, what I mean is this. We are not going to deal with only crop rotation alone. The different departments will be there, like a piggery, poultry, cattle rearing, the snail grass cutters. Meanwhile, even the so-called graduate of agriculture, I'm going to employ them. They've just stand as inspectors. They'll be training people. That's okay, because those are the graduates. They be at least I would make sure that I distribute motor, the cars, bike for them in order to move from one place to another. So they will not be seeing yourself. Maybe I'm in agriculture. Maybe I'm just a farmer. Nobody will try to ridicule you. Thank you.
The CPC, please.
All right. I think I'll say that agriculture remains a very important way to get our boys, our youths off unemployment. Government must support agriculture. I mentioned earlier when I spoke about, you know, government supporting cooperatives, bringing about cooperatives, giving them financial support, laying down guidelines, supporting them in every way to ensure that they are able to help in increasing agricultural production. This will help in finding avenues for creating avenues for youth employment. I think that's very, very crucial. I also will focus on stimulating investments, helping to stimulate different kinds of investments, you know, and that medium, small scale, encouraging our youths to be entrepreneurs, you know, giving them money. Those with ideas will support them to set up their own businesses. I've seen it work in advanced economies, you know, for in places like Britain. Small-scale businesses are the engine. You know, they are the greatest recruiters of people. I will encourage this. In addition, I will also ensure that there's a great priority placed on things like ICT. Information and communications technology, so that our youth can compete in the global marketplace. You know, some of them will find jobs, you know, across the internet. Some of them, you know, will recruit others across the internet. You know, and I will focus also on the moribund industries. You know, I feel sad that a lot of our industries are, you know, Oluwa Glass or oil palm company, they are moribund. There's not the political will to get these industries moving. This will be a priority for a CPC government. With all of that, you know, I think that we'll find a lot of our youth getting into jobs. I don't want to swell the government's recurrent expenditure.
And this is just an aside. Do you know the size of arable land in Ondo State? Do you know how many people can be employed per square kilometer? And what are the products we have in Ondo State?
Can you come again? I didn't get that.
What size of arable land is here in your state? How many people can be employed per square kilometer? And what products do you have here in Ondo State? That's just an aside.
Well, I cannot give you an exact figure on the arable size. I know that we have a large mass of arable farmland. I cannot give an exact figure. I'm not an agri expert. I simply don't know. But what I can say to you is that, you know, we can there's diversity of crops or you know that can be done in Ondo State, cash crops and food crops, you know, that things like cocoa, things like cocoa, coffee, and stuff like that. So and cocoa, you know, has been used to be a pride for this state. We used to be one of the major exporters of cocoa. We need to bring that. We need to bring that kind of pride back to Ondo State. Our youth can be supported to get into these kind of areas.
So it's cocoa and coffee.
Huh?
It's cocoa and coffee.
Yeah, those are two examples. Yeah.
The NCP.
I will encourage our youth to go into partnership. Partnership in the sense that two or three people or four people may come together to establish a company. And as a result, soft loan can then be given to them to operate their company. Having done that, you will see that most of this company will also employ their fellow youth. And this will also bring about employment for the youth. If the youths are encouraged to partner with each other, definitely there will be micro creation of employment. And by the time one or two, three employment is being created, before you know what is happening, you will discover that the people are being employed. Secondly, I will not close my door on employment to civil service, because people are also going out of the civil service. Definitely, I will make sure that as people are going out of civil service, I will also encourage our youth to be employed in the youth service, in the civil service. Then I will make sure that I give soft loan to most of our farmer so that they can go about doing their farming, and as a result, they'll be able to employ one or two people to work with them. And as a result, doing that, you are encouraging employment. These are what I will do to make sure that employment in the state is at least elevated to a certain level.
All right, my panelists will ask the next question.
Water pollution, deforestation, climate change, all these are factors of our environment. Yet we need to create sustainable environment for now and the future generations. What are your policies in this regard?
The APS.
Thank you. The environmental pollution is a global phenomenon. In Ondo State, the previous administrations, they have been doing a lot. They have been campaigning against deforestation, and even the waste management board that was introduced by previous administrations and encouraged and continued by this present administration, they are still very much in vogue and they are performing. So environmentally, we can say Ondo State is one of the advantageous states in the whole country, that this factor is not affecting us so much. But with the little we have seen, the previous administrations, they have been combating the vogue, and they have been encouraged. They encourage people to maintain their environmental factor. That is, to disregard the environmental degradation, to maintain all what they have. So these tree planting activities was introduced by even Adefarati administration, continued by Agagu administration. The present administration is not lacking behind in keeping this. You can see this everywhere. You can see the planting of trees everywhere, even the changes. So the environmental factor about this, we will encourage it. So if you look at the industrialization, the carbon monoxide,
is coming out from the industries. I'm sorry to say, we don't have much industries that can eject the carbon monoxide, the CO, into our atmosphere. So our ozone layer is still very much comfortable. We are still most comfortable with it. So, but by the time we have an industrialized society, we can do some other things. This industrialization to curb the rejection of the carbon monoxide, the poisonous gas that emits to the air. So, thank you.
I want to take you up on that, I may. That our ozone layer is still very safe.
Yeah.
I'm sure you agree with me that Ondo State ozone layer is inside Nigeria's ozone layer as well.
Yeah.
And with the flash floods here and there, we've never had it this bad.
Yeah.
With the flash floods here and there, natural disasters here and there.
Yeah.
How come you say our ozone layer is still safe?
The ozone layer of the Southwest Stan State, I may say, is still very much better than the other areas. You cannot compare the ozone layer of Lagos to ozone layer of Ondo State, because Ondo State is industrialized. That is why you see Victoria Island, all the rich people, they move to Victoria Island. They cannot live in Ikeja, Ilupeju, K2, Moshi. They cannot live in those areas. So the ozone layer of those places, they are so much contacted that the people in that area, here we enjoy this phenomenon than these people. See the flood in Lokoja, we don't have such a thing. Even we have rivers, ocean in Ondo State. Thank you.
The BN, but let me quickly say that you make it sound like Ondo State is not within Nigeria's geographical, like it's not in Nigeria. It's the same ozone layer.
I am saying we are better.
Okay. BNPP, please.
Thank you. I would like to highlight some things about it. I would like to highlight some things when CPN have just said. He made mention of environmental pollution, whatever. What he mean in Ondo State is that the Ondo State there is no much industry in Ondo State that can cause air pollution, that can cause problem for us compared to Lagos. That is what he's trying to say. For me, I believe that in Ondo State, our environmental is very okay, and we are living in a better place. Because if you look at people in Lagos, they will say that okay, I'm come back to Ondo State. I just want to come and rest in Ondo State because the environmental situation in Nigeria. I mean, in Ondo State, the environmental area. I mean, in Ondo State is very okay than the Lagos State, because if you look at the Lagos State, the place is very jam-packed, very very tight. So there is no any space in that place. But in Ondo State, you see that we have space. There are a lot of chances for us here. So if we look at the trees that we are planted now, so you see that it's even hard with the environmental. It's protecting our house, protecting our environment. So it doesn't allow any problem. It protecting something that I don't know how can I put something like that. So
If I understood you well.
Yes, sir.
What you're saying, therefore, is that in Ondo State we have no problems of the environment. And therefore, if industries pollute the environment, you are not going to pursue industrialization in Ondo State. And do you think the fishermen and women in SAO Do Ilaje would agree with you that there is no pollution in Ondo State?
Well, the question you are asking is that I just believe that there is no much pollution in Ondo State. That is what I mean, sir.
Thanks.
All right, the CPC.
Well, let me just say that a CPC government, if elected into power, will take the environment very, very seriously. You know, we'll tackle the environmental challenges that we face, which include some of those which you have mentioned, deforestation, which includes pollution. We'll take it very, very seriously. We have to ensure that, you know, first and foremost, there must be proper regulation. We'll have to empower the appropriate ministry or agency to ensure that people, you know, who are intent on ensuring deforestation, you know, people are made aware and are prevented from bringing about deforestation, for example. And I also ensure, for me, there's, you know, serious pollution. Particularly, you know, you mentioned the Lajeado area. I've seen. I think that companies that are involved in the exploitation of oil from that area must be made to live up to their responsibilities. You know, we must prevent a situation where there is such a pollution of environments, and where that this happens, they must have a corporate policy to ensure that, you know, the people in these areas are well compensated. Government, under my leadership, will ensure that we'll put in place serious guidelines, which government will enforce. And, you know, it's not just about pollution. We have in place like Lajeado, again, we have things like Lakwa and all of that. Government will take all of this seriously. Across the state, we have one of the most environmentally friendly states. A government that has clear guidelines for industries.
The NCP.
Thank you very much. If voted into power, we encourage planting of trees. Mm-hmm. We make sure that if you cut a tree, you must plant a tree. We make sure that we formulate a policy that will guide against water pollution. And during the exploration or exploitation of oil, in case there is water pollution, we'll make sure that the company involved will be sanctioned accordingly or pay remuneration to the community. We will also make sure that we prevent sand pollution by bringing together all our churches and the mosque and then advise them on sound pollution. We also make sure that we discourage industrial pollution. We may say we don't have much industry today, but at least with the little ones that are in operation, we make sure that their waste from their industry are well kept or are not channeled into either our river or to an area that will be toxic to the environment. This we will do jealously. And we also institute a research and development center within our party to make sure that we go throughout the state and look at the possibility of water of any pollution in an area and the remedy that we do jealously.
The ACP?
Yes. There is something we call ecosystem. Once the ecosystem is destabilized, there will be environmental pollution. The problem is in our planning. If we plan very well, if the rate at which individuals build houses, individuals' rate of building, they are faster than the government. It should be the other way around. We expect that everywhere there should be planning. If we go, thank God for what the present government is doing. But if you go to other parts of the town, you cannot go between buildings. No toilet, no anything. So if there are, to all these ones display the ecosystem, because plants are so important. Why are plants important? Because plants, during photosynthesis, plants give out oxygen. We, human beings and animals, we take in oxygen. We let out carbon dioxide. It is the carbon dioxide in reaction with other things that cause environmental pollution, including cancer.
So we must try and act fast and make sure that the ozone layer is not depleted. Already we are part of Nigeria, it's depleted. So we have to move fast. First of all, people coming for industries, Environmental Impact Assessment Act is available. The civil servants doing it must not compromise it, because it will affect the soul of somebody else. Cancer is new here. We are not expecting it, but it's a foreign disease. But there are people here having cancers. I mean, in Ondo State. Nobody can say that we are free of environmental pollution. Akure to have a capital development authority beside Ministry of Works that will plan it very well, so that buildings are spaced, there will be grasses, there will be plants. Then if you cut one, you must put it. For example, in our area in Dori, if you cut a log, because there are government laws, you must plant one. That is, if you don't employ, if you don't do it, the locality will do it. Sorry.
All right, we want to delve into the economy, shall we? Starting with the BNPP, what tax policies should the people of Ondo State expect from your administration if elected governor of this, of the Sunshine State?
Thank you. Our party, we believe one thing, that we like to tell the people of Ondo State that, because by paying your tax, if you pay your tax, at least we it's going to boost the economy of Ondo State. And as well, our party are going to do something, mapping the strategy in the way that if you are a worker, we know that your tax is being already deducted by your salaries. And why the other people that are not workers, maybe they are market women and other people, so we believe that we are going to encourage them to pay tax in order to boost the economy of Ondo State, because what current present administration is doing now, you know, if you look at the signboard in outside, they will say that pay your tax. And because we believe there is one of those things that is contributing to the development of a state. And by paying tax, we believe that every economy, all our sectors, the industries and other things will be, at least we believe that will be developed by the present, I mean by our government. So we are not going to be lack of saying that if you don't pay, we are not going to be lack of we are not going to be lack of something that may be seen that if you can't pay your tax, so we are going to be we are going to pursue you a tax cutter. We can never do that, but we urge you, with a kind of encouragement, you know, to our people, that they should please and pay their tax.
I asked for the tax policy.
Tax policy.
Yes.
Okay. Tax policy. Okay. Well, I just believe that tax policy in economy is that.
Sorry.
Tax policy in economy.
Yes.
Well, I don't have much thing to say about tax policy, because I believe that our party we believe that we are going to, by voting us into power, we are going to sit in round table and see what we can do about tax policy. Thank you.
All right, the CPC.
Well, the tax policy of a CPC government was very clear. We'll put in place a progressive tax policy that basically allows those who are able to generate more revenue to pay more commensurately vis-a-vis those who earn less, you know. So what I'm saying in essence is that if you earn, say, a million, you're definitely going to pay in percentage terms, you're going to pay much more than somebody who earns, for example, 10,000 naira. So, and we also have a situation where, you know, one of the reasons that why I believe that people have, some of our people have you know, been very, very critical of the tax system is that, you know, they don't even see where their money is going. They you know, taxes are collected and people cannot see the result of those taxes you know, and people obviously will feel extremely bad. We will ensure that the mechanisms, we will first of all ensure that the things that we put money in, people can see them very clearly, can appreciate what government is doing, and will then block loopholes, you know, that prevent people from from not paying their taxes appropriately, so that government can generate as much revenue as possible to be able to take care of development projects. So it's a progressive tax policy, a policy that allows the closing of loopholes and ensure that people are able to pay across the board taxes fairly.
What about tax evasion by companies and some individuals?
Of course, tax evasion will be addressed very seriously, because we cannot have companies who, for example, we would give tax breaks to companies when they come in, you know, so as to ensure that they're able to get into production or do their businesses as well as...
The NCP, please.
Thank you very much. By the special grace of God, when I assume power, I will make sure that I sensitize the Ondo people for the need to pay tax regularly. This I will do by introducing what we call TIN, tax identification number, to everybody. Because if you look at Ondo State today, it's only civil servants that are paying their tax as at when due, because they can deduce it, deduct it from their salary. Most of the wealthy man, most of the businessmen in Ondo State today, it is a very blunt truth. Most of them are not even paying tax. But if there is what we call tax identification number, which is going to be given to everybody in the state, then it does mean that the leakage in tax collection will be blocked, because from the state inland revenue, one can now know what the certain amount a company is making, and the appropriate tax will be collected from such people. We'll make sure that we block all the loopholes, because, and we also make sure that we do visible things. Because if you are a tax payer and you notice physical infrastructure or physical things that your tax is being used for, happily you want to pay, you don't want to evade tax. We will encourage people to pay tax by letting them know the tax we collect from them and what we use it for. Thank you very much.
The ACPN.
Yes, our people should realize that it is not a punishment to pay tax. My father paid tax, I paid. But I know my mother doesn't pay tax. This is because at that time, I think generally the tendency is to assume that women don't do much. But we are going to use what we call a moral suasion. It is not a question of force. You use moral suasion. And especially in the case of cocoa, which is the main agricultural cash crop in the state, I will make sure that we go back to the old system of a marketing board. Because nowadays, individuals just dry their cocoa and take it to anywhere to sell. But there will be Ondo State marketing board. That was how Awolowo financed everything he did in the Western region. It was Western Nigeria Marketing Board. Because I could remember that there was a time that my father would say, we have not had the price from the marketing board. And once they get the price, the cocoa will be well organized. There will be check testers, there will be examiners. So the appropriate taxes will be paid. But this situation whereby you dry your cocoa, somebody from Bende or somebody from Ekiti could come and buy it at about 1,200 naira per kg, and you put the money in your pocket, the government will be losing. So the government has to tighten up and set up a marketing board that will all cocoa, all cash crop, including coffee, they will be graded, and then they will be moved or even processed to another product. So all those loopholes will be blocked. That is why we don't have enough taxes, because there are infiltration by neighboring states. They collect our cocoa, they collect our coffee, and go and sell in their state, because there are no marketing board. If there are marketing board, all these loopholes will be built. And moral suasion will make sure our women pay tax. Thank you.
APS.
Our people will say, to whom much is given, much is expected. And I will also reverse it, that to whom much is expected, much has to be given. Honestly, I will pity the taxpayer in Nigeria. I will pity them. Because predominantly, the direct taxes is a little bit effective because of the payee policy. Now, these indirect taxes from all other places is expected to be given, the payers expected to be given the basic infrastructures, pipe-borne water, electricity, good roads. So the people at the village there, they don't give them good road. Then you ask them to pay tax. They will ask you, tax on what? Now, if you expect tax from these people, you have to encourage the taxpayer. Let them see, try and put some things. Then you point to that thing that this infrastructure is getting to you through tax. But I'm sorry to say, what are we going to show for the tax being collected from the artisans, from the workers outside there, except those that pay directly? So if we want to encourage paying tax, we will put basic infrastructures, even to the grassroots. Then these basic infrastructures will encourage the payers. Pipe-borne water, electricity, good roads, and some other things, good health, schools, and some other things, we put them there. It will encourage the taxpayer. Tax is easy to collect, but on what? You have to establish that for our people that pay tax. On what are they paying this tax?
I want to find out how your tax policy would affect the elderly and the fiscally challenged if voted into power.
That's exactly what I just said. The soft tax policy that the government of APS is going to operate, we shall first of all see to the basic infrastructure that affects those people that you have mentioned. If these people see it, if I can tell you, some physically challenged people, roads are not getting to their school or to their homes. So we must first of all develop or improve their welfare being. When we develop their welfare being, then we can ask them to pay tax on what we have provided. But we cannot ask them to pay tax on what we have not provided. Because such tax, I will not pay it. I will evade that type of tax.
Yeah. Still on economy, state and local government joint account is more or less a cost rather than blessing to local government. What should be done, and how do you intend to solve this problem if elected in Ondo State?
Thank you very much. Are you throwing the question to me?
No, it's the CPC, okay. I suppose.
Get that.
You want me to repeat the question?
Yes.
Yeah. Yes, joint account between state and local government is more or less a cost rather than blessing to local government administration. How do you intend to address this problem in Ondo State if elected?
Is that a question for me or for him?
Use, please. Okay. The CPC, please.
Okay. Oh, thank you. Right. I think that as much as possible, one of the saddening things that I've noticed is a situation where funds meant for local governments are basically used by the states, you know, and local governments are given paltry sums to prosecute projects, and local government state administrations take over the functions of local government. I don't think this is impressive. I think it's actually unfortunate. What needs to happen is that as a responsible government, we will ensure that local governments have their allocations in their accounts, so that they can deliver on their own their mandate to the people at the grassroots. We will, of course, provide guidelines to ensure that these expectations are met, that the mandate is delivered. But we will try to basically separate as much as possible the allocations or the funds of states from local government, so that both tiers of government can deliver effectively their mandates to government. I don't want to see a situation where my state government, for example, is taking credit for what should otherwise be credit to the local governments. Local governments should be allowed to perform their roles. But yes, of course, a responsible chief executive at the state level should monitor what they do, and that includes ensuring that their allocations get to them on time and in their own accounts.
Thanks, CP.
Thank you very much. We will make sure we encourage separation of power. We'll make sure that the money meant for local government goes to them without any interruption. Having said that, but because if elected as the number one citizen of the state, I'll make sure that this money will be properly monitored, so that at the end of the day, what is expected to use the money for are achieved. I would discourage it totally. A situation whereby money meant for local government is with state government. Thank you very much.
All right, the ACPN.
There is nothing wrong in having separation of powers. But everything depends on us. There is nothing wrong in having a professor as a chairman of a local government. But when you get somebody at home who has no qualification, you make him the chairman of the local government, somebody who has never earned 40,000. You ask him to come and manage 2 million. He will mess it up. That's why you have the state government interacting with the local government. Before he does so, the salaries of teachers who are paid, along with because the local government are expected to be responsible for payment of salaries of teachers, they first of all take that money, they take it to the bank. They will fix it. For 2 or 3 months, the teachers will go on strike. Then later they get it. Is the type of caliber of personnel that is in the local government that is making it difficult for the state government to release it. As long as we don't have decent people with reputation, retired permanent secretaries, professors who have come back to their local, let them compete and head local government. I learned that when President Shagari left the office, he went back to his Tokoto as a councillor. How many of us can do it here? Be parading around the government office that you are the former president. Individual here must be ready to go to their local government and serve. If they are equally qualified like the people in the state government, then they cannot be messed up. For example, if I'm asked to go to my local government after retirement, then no governor can. I will protest. Why are you taking part of the money? It belongs to us. But as long as we have those category of people, the state government will not want to lose the local government. Thank you.
APS, please.
Thank you very much. The joint account that you have just mentioned, if the account is to be left, if we are to divide the accounts of the local government to the states, most of the projects being executed by the local government, I can tell you 70% of it is being sponsored by the state government. Now, if the APS is voted into power, we first of all establish good local government administration. That is, we conduct election. And if we conduct election, we establish the local government. Now, we will first of all put to the federal government. We have to review the accounts of the local government, because the local government is the closest to the people among the three tiers of government, the federal, state, and the local. The local government needs more money. They need more money. The money being allocated to the local government is not enough. I will say emphatically, the state is executing those projects, 70% of their projects. So the joint account committee that you are talking about is not the essence of good governance, is not the essence, the number of projects that you executed, but the number of people that benefited from such projects. And that is the ultimate aim of the state government. So the state government will oversee, in spite of establishing good local government administration, the state government will oversee the spendings of the local government to extend the gesture to the masses, because the money of the masses must be spent for the masses. Thank you.
Would you like to champion a process by which that constitutional provision of the joint account is established, be reviewed? And how would you do it?
Good. We have the state legislatures. The state legislature will first of all prove it on the floor that the constitution must be reviewed. And if the two-thirds of the local government of the legislature agreed, then they will pass it to the House of Representatives. From House of Representatives, they will pass it to the Senate. Then the Senate will sit on it. And if they agree upon it, then the president will assign it and it becomes law. So, thank you.
BNPP.
Thank you. The joint account, our party will see it as something that is very, is not good enough. Actually, why we said it's not good enough is the problem is the hand of federal government. The reason is that we believe that a state government is a body on their own, while local government is another body on their own. Why, the local government account and the state and local government account is very bad. I believe that if the federal government says that we are going to separate this body, the federal government is going to stipulate out of the law that the state government will be earn their money directly from from the federal, while the local government will be earn their money. So the money will be used judiciously by the local government, while the one comes to the state will be used judiciously. But by the version that when the joint account have made by the federal government, so I believe is the rep, the senate, they are the legislation on top. They are the one they are the one in position to address the issue. It's not by the masses. Even if my colleague says that the state legislature, they might even say something about it. But by the state, by the version is that when the governor of the state says that, look, shame upon Lowe, can't you know that we are using out of this money to build some to do some things to develop states, and out of the local government account, just the little money by state removing their own shares, so the little one will move down to the local government, and they be seeing that they are not performing. Thank you.
Do you have an idea how much local governments make monthly in Ondo State?
Actually, I can't really say per se, because I don't know. I'm not in the system, and I don't know how I'll be saying what I don't know. Because that is why I'm urging the people of Ondo State that they should vote us in, so we know what is going on, so we are going to address the issue. That's just it.
Yeah, but I suppose you would know that allocations to state, federal, and local governments is public knowledge. They are published.
What do you say, sir?
That how much local governments get on a monthly basis is information that is published. It is not in any archive.
But it's not...
published.
At times, it's a confidential issue. So it's not every month that been what the local government is sending is showcased to the people of Ondo State. I don't really know anything about that. So I must tell you the truth. So thank you.
Next question for the NCP.
Next question.
Yes, please.
Okay. Many experts, economic experts, believe that the best period for Nigeria regarding its economic growth was when we had the national development plans, which has now been jettisoned. What did
development plan would you propose to operate if you become governor of Ondo State?
Thank you very much. You mean economic development plan?
National development plan, state development plan.
Yes. If voted into power, I will make sure that I project some economic policy for the state in terms of in terms of how to generate enough revenue for the state. This I will do, like I said earlier, by first of all, look at our coastal area in the state. That coastal area in the state can fetch enough money for the state without even looking forward to the money accrued from oil revenue. This I will pursue jealously with necessary organ of federal government to see that we have our port in the state. If we have a port in the state, that port will not only fetch money for the state alone. Look at Republic of Benin, they live on this port alone. If we annex port establishment in the state, we'll have enough money. This will also attract company. It will also attract industrialization in the state, because we now discover that movement of raw materials to the state will be easier through the port. The finished goods again can be moved from the state to other part of the world. We will make sure that all these things are jealously pursued.
NCP.
Yes, sir.
I do take your point on how to generate revenue from various sources.
Yeah.
But we are talking about development plans. 1 year development plan, 2 year development plan, 4 year rolling plan. Which kind of plan? And you can then fit this, how you generate resources,
okay,
into that kind of plan.
Yes. We have 10-point development plan in our party. 10-point development plan. Okay. In our party. This is we start from, well, I hope I get your question right, please.
Well,
I don't want to.
I'm not sure.
Okay.
We're talking about development plans. Today, we go from year to year.
Yes.
Before now, we used to have a 4-year development plan nationally.
Yeah.
Which was then jettisoned.
Okay.
But experts seem to agree that the years when we had those development plans, economic growth was being encouraged.
Yeah.
But now that we have yearly development plans, things seem not to work well. So what kind of economic development plan would you propose for Ondo State?
Okay. I think I would prefer going, who will meet, our research and development department will meet and deduce a 4-year development program. Because we discovered that most of the program introduced cannot be finished within a year. And because government is a continuity, there is need for us to develop according to the plan of the government without even saying that this is what we are going to do for this year, and at the end of the day, we don't do anything in the subsequent year. We have 4-year development program on roads, on agriculture. All the blueprint will be available or are already available. What we are just needed is that by the time we occupy that coveted seat, we now make everything known, and before you know what is up, thank you very much.
For ACPN.
This, if we fail to plan, we are planning to fail. So there must be 5 years or 10 years development plan, out of which will be broken down to yearly basis. Whether you are there or not, if it is the consensus of everybody in the state, it should be adhered to. You will now sit in the office and follow the plan rigidly.
along the line, there could be some adjustment. But there must be 10-year development plan. That's why the past was better. Now there is nothing like a plan, except the annual budget. If you are planning like that, you cannot do anything. So there must be about 10-year development plan. Then all the loopholes, every month, if you take that of, this is 2012. If you take the plan of 2012, you take it out of the 10-year development plan, you sit down, every month there will be cyclical account. All the expenditures will be monitored vis-a-vis, you place it beside the plan and see if the expenditure and the revenue, if they tally, if there's any deviation, you make adjustment. With that, the year will be broken into cycles. Let's say about 12 or 13 cycles, which will coincide with a month. With that, you'll be able to monitor it and block all loopholes. Every week, the Commissioner for Finance will monitor every ministry and their plans and will draw their attention to it. You are deviating. And then everybody, even if it has approved by the governor, must be able to defend his cyclical expenses. But here, people will just be doing it as if nothing happens. That's why our plans fail. Thank you.
APS.
The APS government, if voted to power, we are going to adopt the 4-year development plan because the constitution says we should spend 4 years. And these, our projects, we start from day one because spanning our projects across the 4 years, we know that by the end of the 4 years, we will have covered so much. We will have achieved about 80% of our projects and our plans. So our plan now is to reduce the poverty to the bearable minimum level. We want to reduce the poverty because we can say that there is poverty in our society. So the first problem is to, the first solution to upgrade our society is to reduce the poverty. So how do we reduce the poverty? Executing our projects, creating employment, infrastructure at the grassroots level and the urban center, then health, improving our education, all those policies, we will span it for the period of the 4 years. So our development plan will cover the 4 years. And by the end of our administration, we know that at least we have covered at least 80% of our plan, developmental plan. Thank you.
You can cover 80% of your developmental plans within four years.
Yes.
The BNPP.
I would like to let you people know that the plans you have made mention is that it's very easy for every one of us to plan. If you fail to do it, what you plan about, what we are discussed upon, it's very easy to have a focus. You don't need to be saying that you want to plan. It's good for you to plan, but you need to focus some things that you want to do. Like our party, we, by the time that we vote into a power, we believe that we are going to sit in round table. We look at the area that has a loopholes in Ondo State. We are going to cover those places. Firstly, and those things that we met on grant with present party, the present ruling party, Ikuben party now, or even the previous one, we are going to cover those aspects before we
time frame. Within what time and what time? Time frame.
Yeah, by at least before a year, at least we are going to cover at least 50% of our plan. By the 4 years runs out, we believe that we are going to cover 88%. So that's just it. Thank you.
CPC.
I agree very much that we should have development plans, and I would just go for a 4-year development plan for obvious reasons. The people of Ondo State will have elected me for 4 years, and it's only sensible that I am able to plan and account for the years that I've been elected. So
for a four-year development plan will be my focus. And that development plan will encompass all the different areas of governance. It will cover education, health, economic activities, culture, and all of that. So a four-year development plan that covers all the different areas of governance. And perhaps I must emphasize here, beyond the plan, it's a rigorous pursuit of those plans. One of the things that we found out, part of the bane of government in this climate is the fact that, there's no planning. Some people don't have an idea of what they do want to do in government, and even when they set plans, perhaps those plans are put together for them by some people. It's as if those plans do not matter. They don't follow that plan. I want to see within that 4-year development plan, what I call even for budgetary discipline, where we say that this is what we're going to do, this is the amount of money we're going to invest in this, and we follow that rigorously. That is not to say we're not going to make reviews, but there must be a commitment to following the plan and ensuring that there's prudence, budget prudence, there's prudence in governance, and ensuring that the objectives set are achieved. That is very important as well.
All right, we are afraid we may not be able to take further questions now, but we would like to ask all our candidates to please give their closing remarks at this time, after which the chairman of the NEDG will, and the chairman of RAPA, DAC Communications PLC, excuse me, will come present your certificates of participation. Now you have, we'll start with you, the ACPN, for your closing remarks, a wrap up of why you should be voted into office. Your time starts now. Yes.
Thank you very much. Like I said earlier, I have come to the state to tell and implement the rejection story. We have dreams for the state which we want to implement. The state must not be left in this. We want to improve on what is on the ground. We are very happy at what we have seen, because when those of us who schooled here, accuracy was not like this when we were here. We are happy, but there are other ways of doing it. For example, I have not seen plans for the circular roads. There must be circular roads. I expect somebody coming from Owo, going to Idori, to have a bypass there and go without coming to the city. I said somebody coming from Ondo going to Idori to bypass and go. Those are how our cities can be developed. And when we come into power, those are the things. So that our generation coming, we can't be blaming people all the time. If the infrastructures are there, people coming, they will improve on it. So that's the thing we want to implement. I thank everybody here, especially the organizers, for giving us, especially me, the opportunity to explain my dream to the state. And I'm sure that I will not disappoint you. Thank you.
The APS.
Thank you very much for giving us this ample opportunity. And I want the people of Ondo State to vote for the APS, to vote for me. And if I'm voted to the power, I want to reduce the poverty to the barest minimum, because I'm very close to the masses anyway, because my government is going to execute the masses-oriented projects. Because the projects that to be executed is how many people are benefiting from that project, not the amount of projects that we execute that matters. Now, we want to execute a project, all these projects will benefit the masses the more, at least the masses, because we are having the masses at the receiving end of the economy. So I want the people of Ondo State to vote for the APS. APS is always at the place for the masses. We are masses-oriented party. So we love masses, and we are going to serve the masses, and we are going to serve the people of Ondo State in general. Thank you.
The BNPP.
Thank you, my moderators. I would like to thank the people of Ondo State. And because our party, we are really
equipped and prepared to gain the people's mind by see what we are going to do, what we are going to do if we are voted in. And I believe that by this time around, I'm going to thank the people of Ondo State for giving me privilege and the organizer of this program to stand on existing program protocol to address, to speak my mind to the good people of Ondo State. Thank you.
The CPC.
I like to say to people in Ondo State that you know, over the years I've gone around the state, you know, and what I see, you know, is not very impressive. But we see squalor and poverty everywhere. We need an infrastructure decay. We need to break from this business as usual pattern. You know, we need to have a breath of fresh air in terms of governance in this state. We need a government that can bring real transformational change across the state, in Akure or War, Ilaje, everywhere. You know, no longer should our people be satisfied with the situation where things are not happening. You know, you have all this decay everywhere. The CPC government is going to be an accountable government, a transparent government, a government of property, a government that is going to remarkably change the situation of things in Ondo State. I urge our people to vote wisely. It's an historic opportunity. And I say that CPC will make Ondo State a reference point in governance in this country and beyond. Thank you.
The National Conscience Party.
Thank you very much. My sincere gratitude goes to the organizer of this debate. I'm also grateful to the security agencies for creating an enabling environment, an environment devoid of katakata. I must say clearly that NCP is a party for the grassroots. Our blueprint is already there. All what we need is just to solicit for your vote. When you vote us in, we are going to kick out. We are going to kick out poverty from the state. You will see that if you studied our four cardinal points, everything that we want to do is already there. We'll give you kudos for listening to us. Thank you very much.
All right, I'd like to invite the chairman of the NEDG, Aremotaiwo Alimi, to give the vote of thanks, and after which the translator will interpret his vote of thanks in Yoruba. Then the certificates of participation will be given by the Board of Trustees representing the Chairman of Dark Communications PLC and the National Orientation Agency Director, Mr. Bode Famosi. After which we'll wrap up properly and then take the national anthem. May I ask all the audience to please remain seated as we do this. Thank you.
Thank you very much. We want to specially thank the governorship candidates that have focused on the election debate today for their dedication to service to the people of Ondo State. We also want to commend the audience for the exhibition of good value system and profound support of the election debate today. The governorship candidates of the ACN, Labour Party, NSDP, PDP, PDC, and PPA have all confirmed their willingness to be on the election debate here tomorrow. We really, really commend their commitment to the strengthening of democracy in Ondo State. And I invite my colleague for the Yoruba translation.
A fe fi asiko yi dupe lowo gbogbo yin, gbogbo awon igbimo ati awa ero to wa nikale ati gbogbo eyin ti en wo wa nile ni ipinle yi lorilede Nigeria ati ni gbogbo agbaye ati pelu awon oludije si ipo gomina ni ipinle Ondo to wa loni adupe lowo gbogbo yin fun ifarabalẹ yin ati fun bi e se n ba wa fokan ba lo be na la dupe lowo eyin ero ti o wa ni kale wi pe o aro wa ta pa si yin ni ibere eto yi e fowo so wo ko pelu wa lati farabalẹ lati ri pe fun gbogbo awon oludije ni anfani bakan na ati dupe pe ko si ariwo ko si bomi si omi ojo e si dasi arin eto na e se pupo ati wa nfi asiko yi so fun gbogbo agbaye ati eni ti e wa ni bi wi pe awon oludije si ipo gomina ti o ku ti won o ti wa le ni tori a le ku ogun si bi awon na nbo lola awon ni egbe oselu ACN Labour Party, NSDP, PDP, PDC, ati PPA. Awon oludije si ipo gomina ni abe osolu wonyi ni won ti so fun wa wi pe awon ma wa ni bi ni ola fun eto idije eto iftakuroso ti won. Be na ni a si fe ki gbogbo wa ki a tete de si kale ago marun ni eto yi bere lola adupe lowo gbogbo yin e se pupo.
I will now invite the great founding member of the NEDG Board of Trustees, Chief Raymond Dopesi, and the State Director of NOAA to join me in presenting the certificates of participation to the candidates that are featured today. With privilege, the Nigerian Elections Debate Group readily and willingly and happily present this certificate of participation to the governorship candidate of Allied Congress Party of Nigeria for participating in the Ondo State 2012 governorship debates today, 27th day of September 2012. We congratulate you.
On behalf of the Nigeria Elections Debate Group, NEDG, it is my great honor and privilege to present this certificate of participation in the Ondo State Governorship Debates to you, comrades, on this day, the 27th day of September 2012. Congratulations.
On behalf of the Nigeria Elections Debate Group, I hereby present this certificate of participation to you as an attestation of your participation in the governorship debates that has been organized by the Nigeria Elections Debate Group today. Congratulations.
On behalf of the Nigeria Elections Debate Group, I wish to present this certificate of participation to the candidate of the Congress for Progressive Change, CPC, Olusoji Ehinlau, for participating in this governorship debate this day, 27th day of September 2012. Congratulations.
On behalf of the Nigeria Elections Debate Group, I present this certificate to you, Oladipo Lawrence, the governorship candidate of the National Conscience Party, for participating in this governorship debate today, the 27th day of September 2012. Congratulations.
Well, that's the debate for the first session of the governorship debate today, the 27th of September 2012. The 2012 Ondo State Governorship Deputy Governorship Debate is brought to you by the Nigerian Elections Debate Group, the NEDG, with support from INEC and BON,
Bond member stations are our official broadcasters, Africa Independent Television, AIT, and the Nigerian Television Authority, NTA, who are the official TV production stations for global distribution of the debate signal. While Africa's biggest radio network, Radio Nigeria and Voice of Nigeria, are our official radio production stations. To our viewers and listeners in Ondo State, Nigeria, and across the globe, many thanks for watching and for listening. Bye for now. May we all rise for the national anthem, please.